renewal. The talk will be up to 45 minutes, followed by 45 minutes of discussion, and we'll have some refreshments afterwards. So the floor is yours, Dr. Imad.
Thank you very much, Dr. Alex. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salati wa salam ala ashraf al-mursaleen, Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. First of all, thank you so much for this kind introduction, and thanks for taking the time to come to this talk. Dean Shanturk, of course, I know that how busy you are, and I really appreciate taking the time away from busy schedule just to come and listen to my lecture, and all the distinguished professors, the students, and everyone. I really appreciate it. What I will try to do is just, this is a straightforward presentation of a forthcoming work that I'm supposed to submit by the end of this month to the Oxford Handbook of Islamic Reform. And actually, my colleague to my left, Dr. Alex, has already contributed a chapter to this work. So I'm really glad to join his good company. The title, as Dr. Alex mentioned, is Muhammad Rashid Rida, Between Traditionalism and Renewal. And the main objectives of the chapter, I'm talking about the chapter itself, and as I mentioned, it's a chapter in a handbook, so things a little bit straightforward and introductory more than very sophisticated, but has to be analytical, of course. I have three main objectives. One is to revisit a commonplace assumptions about Muhammad Rashid Rida. Muhammad Rashid Rida is always known or described as someone who has aborted the reformist efforts of Afghani and Abdu at renewal and at reform and revival of Islamic thought and so on. يعني أجهد حركة النهضة أو حركة التجديد الإسلامي التي قادها الأفغاني وعبدو. And I will do this throughout the lecture because I have here yani, good friends who might, you know, benefit from the Arabic as well. So I'll do English and maybe just, you know, leading statements in Arabic. The other assumption is that he was merely a mouthpiece for Abdu, Turjuman Afkaru. Yani, he was, even Abdu himself described Muhammad Rashid Rida that he was Turjuman Afkari and a translator of his thought. So he's not really a chief or main contributor in terms of his own original novel ideas to reform. And the third assumption that he was not actually a reformer, لم يكن مجددا, but a traditionalist promoting conservative Salafi and Wahhabi thoughts. And Rashid Rida ended up not being a reformer, deviating away from the movement of renewal or the renewal reformist movement of Afghani and Abdu, and then started to align with the new state in Saudi Arabia, Ibn Saud and the Wahhabi and Salafi traditions and so on. And therefore, as I mentioned earlier, kind of ended this movement of Islamic modernism, Harakat al-Tahdith al-Islami. Many people, of course, in retrospect, you know, put a lot of hopes on this movement, like the Harakat al-Tahdith al-Islami could have led to a real revival in Islamic thought and Islamic society and save the Muslim societies from this state of decay and decline and so on. This is exactly what the chapter is going to focus on. And the main arguments four arguments. One, Rida developed a multifaceted reform program. Yani, meaning that he was not an aqil, a transmitter of thought, an imitator, but also he had his own multifaceted reform program. And of course, the key word here is program. A plan of action, a program, some kind of... The second argument, because that will explain it. I argue that his program was much more comprehensive and coherent than that of Afghani and Abdu. And I will explain that through, of course, throughout the chapter. Third, his later Salafi tendencies and methodology obscured the reformist nature of his program, meaning that it's true that at the end or the latter phase of his life, Rashid Rida started to lean towards Salafism, especially in the interpretation, in fatawa, and so on, and even in temper. He was, you know, he was short-tempered at the end, like Afghani. Afghani also was short-tempered at the end when, you know, he started to become frustrated with all of suggestions for reform and they get aborted and so on. So at the end, this Salafi Wahhabi tendency actually, as I mentioned, covered his overall contribution to reform. And that's what this chapter is trying to present, his program of reform. Finally, Rida laid down, and this is, I think, a little bit novel, Rida laid down the foundation of a new phase in Islamic revival. All right, like he, like the same way Afghani and Abdu were a kind of a bridge between pre-modern Islamic reform movements and modern Islamic reform movements, Islamic modernism. Rida actually also bridged to a new movement of revival, in a nutshell, that was taken by Hassan al-Banna and the Muslim Brotherhood and activism and grassroots movements and so on. Let me just, you know, like say a word of caution, because these are all arguable, you know, like controversial. Not everyone agrees. And this is, I think, one of the issues regarding Rashid Rida himself. How to consider him? Some people consider him as a reformer, and some people, or many people, consider him actually as a conservative traditionalist and not a reformer at all. This is the dilemma about Rashid Rida. However, in my view, he has contributed widely and greatly. This is a man who enjoyed a long, relatively long life. He died, he had like 70 years old. He died at the age of 70. And he published Al-Manar. It's a periodical, a monthly periodical that lasted for 35 years. So, and each volume, 35 volumes, each volume was 960 pages. And I will explain very quickly. So he had major, he has made, and he was writing everything almost on his own. So he had a major, or he made a major contribution in this regard. Of course, I deal with the background, but in a nutshell, because I think we have time, but in a nutshell, he was of Syrian origin, Syrian by Grand Syria, because he was born actually in Lebanon, near Tripoli, but he was of Syrian origin, received, coming from a notable family that claims descent to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And of course, as the tradition during these times, he received traditional education, but good traditional education in addition to some modern subjects, you know, arithmetics, mathematics, and some kind of, you know, like social, a little bit of social sciences and so on. But the most important element was one of his teachers was Sheikh Hussein al-Jisr. Sheikh Hussein al-Jisr was, again, one of the reformers of the generation of Rifa'a al-Tahtawi of Egypt and so on, people that tried to save Islam by synthesizing between Islam and modern subjects and so on. This is a very kind of a traditional old story known for those who study Islamic reform and in the Arab world. As I mentioned, he received a traditional education. He flirted with Sufism, read Ihya Ulum al-Din by Ghazali and so on. And the man was, you know, like into this kind of track until he came across Al-Urwa al-Wusqa. Al-Urwa al-Wusqa was a magazine that was published by Al-Afghani and Abdu in the end of the 19th century, calling for, again, reform and revival and salvaging and rescuing Islam from the threat of imperialism and so on. So it ignited his life, completely transformed his life and his orientation, that and made him decide to join Afghani. He became very kind of, you know, infatuated with Jamal al-Din al-Afghani. So he wanted to join him physically, to travel to him, a young man. Afghani was, of course, in Istanbul under house arrest. He couldn't join him. So the second, he wrote to him, corresponded with him. Anyway, the second best choice was to join Abdu when Abdu returned from exile from Beirut to Egypt end of 19th century. So he moved to Egypt in 1898 at the age of 33. So he was mature at that time, of course, and stayed there until his death in 1935. This is one characteristics about, you know, living for a long time in Egypt. And this is something that touched me, because he kept complaining throughout. He said, you know, I lived in Egypt all my life, almost all my adult life. And Egyptians, when they are happy with you, they claim you as an Egyptian. He's Syrian origin. And when you disagree with them, they claim you as foreign and you should leave the country. So he kept, you know, like suffering from this issue about the Egyptian. Anyway. So he lived there, of course, and he considered himself, of course, as an Egyptian. He's very well connected with the political circles, intellectual circles, and social.
Without visa
at that time, because it was just Ra'ayat Dawla al-Osmaniyah. يعني I saw one of these kind of passports انك من رعايا الدولة العثمانية.
The essence of أمة.
طبعا borders and أمة but to some extent not to a large extent because he was threatened so many times and like الكواكبي like others and so on. In Egypt, you know, he published Al-Manar. Al-Manar was something, يعني, if someone has the time, get just an idea. Familiarize yourself with مجلة Al-Manar. Al-Manar lasted from 1898 all the way to 1935. So it's really an expansive, like covered an expansive period of time. And not any period of time. This was not a time of stagnation. This was like a volcano. In the region, in the Middle East and Ottoman Empire and all, it was a period of transformation. Al-Manar, he wrote most, as I mentioned, most of its content, and its content consisted of, it starts with a Tafsir al-Manar that Abdu Muhammad, Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, I would say, you know, like uttered or articulated, and Abdu, and Rashid Rida wrote the prose. I mean, like formulated or wrote the prose of it. So it starts with Tafsir al-Manar, then al-Fatawa, again, Fatawa was Abdu, and then Rida, and then the Maqalat. Al-Maqalat, طبعاً, of course, covering most of the events in the Muslim world, not only in the Arab or Middle East. So al-Maqalat, letters to the editor, scientific and literary articles, news and opinions, biographies, and so on. So it was really a kind of a very informative educational or educative magazine. As I mentioned, 35, when I was young, I read all of them. I was doing my master's on Rashid Rida, and I read all the 35 volumes, the 960, and I got, yes, my disc, my back, you know, problems started there. Anyway, it was a great source, of course, of information, as I mentioned, an analysis on the events that took place during this time. In terms of spread and influence, it really spread very widely, very widely. And, yeah, even some American and British scholars referred to Madrasa al-Manar. يعني Charles Adams, for example, he wrote about Afghani, Abdu, Madrasa al-Manar, and then Talamisa Abdu, the disciples of Abdu, and then Madrasa al-Manar. Like it formulated also Abdu when he visited Muhammad Abdu, when he visited Tunisia, I think it was early 1905, he found that he had followers who said, how did you know about me in Tunisia and Maghreb, because they came from Maghreb. They told him through Al-Manar. Manar spread to Indonesia, but over the years, over so many years, Indonesia, Jakarta, Philippines, and so on, India, Pakistan, Pakistan was not there then, India, and so on. So it really spread throughout the Muslim world, and its ideas also spread. He described Al-Manar Rashid Rida himself as Mijalla Shahriya, monthly magazine, تبحث في فلسفة الدين وشؤون الاجتماع والعمران. It's a monthly magazine that looks into the philosophy of religion, social affairs, and العمران, civilization, matters of civilization and progress and so on. That's how he described this. So you can see, and this is the influence of Abdu and Afghani, and this is really an innovative, of course, orientation within the trend of Islamic reform at that time, the emphasis on social religion. And the social aspects of religion and the idea of Imran, the idea of building, re-establishing something, for example, in the Muslim world. He also described the objectives of Al-Manar as focusing on al-islah al-dini, religious reform, تتركز في الإصلاح الديني والاجتماع الأمة and the social reform for the nation, إبطال الشبهات and revoking all suspicions and accretions and so on, الواردة على الإسلام. وتفنيد ما يعزى إليه من خرافات all superstitions, I mean like eliminating superstitions, تربية البنات والبنين, educating female and male, إصلاح كتب التعليم وطريقة التأليف, reforming education and writing, the methods of writing, that was of course influence of Abdu, and دفع الأمة على مجاراة الأمم المتقدمة في مختلف المجالات, and pushing the Muslim societies to catch up with the advanced nations in all the fields, right? I will come back to this, some of the wording here. So this was the objective of Al-Manar. It has this kind of very comprehensive idea about reform. It was there to reform, and he mentioned it so many times. In the chapter, of course, I will make, and this is some kind of, you know, like a comparison between Al-Urwa al-Wusqa and Al-Manar, because it's very important because this is one of the main arguments that I'm trying to make, that he possessed some kind of his own program of reform, and that program of reform, which was more comprehensive. I think a comparison between the two, Al-Urwa al-Wuthqa and Al-Manar, shows to a large extent this. Al-Urwa al-Wuthqa was mainly focusing on political reform, on issues of shura, mani' al-istibdad, anti-despotism, and so on. It was more of a political and not meant to be comprehensive. And it was also very intellectual, Al-Urwa al-Wuthqa, yani directed to the intelligentsia, if you wish, of Muslim societies. Al-Manar was a little bit different. It was much more comprehensive in its coverage, as I mentioned. The issue of Fatawa made this kind of connection between Al-Manar and this religious elite, if you wish, like Abdu Afghani and Rida and so on, and the masses. They asked them about, you know, ordinary issues and so on that touch their life. And as you will see, it always prescribed practical programs for reform and for change in the Muslim societies. So the context, I refer to the context, this was one of the most transformative, turbulent, precarious contexts maybe in Muslim societies. I never managed to include everything in this list, but just to give you an idea, this is a period that he lived. Now we focus on Rashid Rida, a period in which he lived that witnessed the gradual decline of the Ottoman Empire, the occupation of Muslim territories, the coup and the major transformation within the empire itself of the Committee of Union and Progress of 1908, Arab revolts trying to find an alternate state, the search for a new caliphate, the attempts, we will come to this, of course, the mandate system, which meant the physical occupation of Muslim territories by occupiers, foreign occupiers, and also imperial systems of finance, of banking, of economics, of politics, of everything, and the emergence of the nation states, new borders, Sykes-Picot, and so on. The Balfour Declaration, and he really had some kind of a direct contacts with some of the leaders of the Zionist movement at that time. He met Haim Weizmann, for example, and they discussed this issue of the establishment of Israel. And I will mention something about his really foresight in terms of how to deal with the emerging Zionist entity in the future. And of course, the Kemalist Revolution, he witnessed the Kemalist Revolution, the end of the, as I mentioned, then the abolishment of the caliphate itself, Ataturk as a new hope, and then a frustrated hope, and then the emergence of the Saudi state, and again placing some hope on the rising. I will explain all this, but what I'm trying to say is he tried to interact with all of these events, to have a role in all of these events. At the same time, witnessing all of these events over a period of 70 years, and that's something that many people kind of blamed or criticized Rida for, that he kept shifting his opinions, his views, starting as a reformer, as a revolutionary influenced by Afghani, and then reformer influenced by Abdo, and then revolutionary again, and then conservative, and, you know, like, as I said, short-tempered and so on. But anyone who would witness such events might be exposed to this kind of fluctuation in ideas and thought and so on. I'm 66 years old. My views, for example, when I started to acquire political consciousness, of course, with no comparison with Rida, he was really a kind of a giant. Growing up with Nasserism, Arab unity, that was our bread and life. I mean, Arab unity, there's no question about this. We didn't even recognize, you know, territorial nation states. And until now, I still carry it with me. But all the way to, you know, like Sadat and all these kind, and then you grow up and realize the true nature of the regimes that are leading in the Arab world. So now even you start questioning the state. Like, I feel even at the personal level, and I shouldn't be saying that, but I'm moving toward anarchism more than kind of, you know, a stable, because this, the only solution for all this to go, all this to go. But anyway, that's a different story. Anyway, so anyone who goes through all these, you know, frustrations and developments would acquire or will have some kind of change to their views and so on. I said Rida's reform vision, it was more comprehensive and more rooted than that of Afghani and Abdi. This is, by the way, a big statement that might, you know, really lead to a lot of criticisms, like saying this, that he was more comprehensive and so on. Some, because some people tell you, no, he took refuge in the shelter of Salafism. So everything he kind of prescribed was coming from that perspective. من نظرة ضيقة سلفية ضيقة للإصلاح. He withdrew, if you wish. Some people think that he withdrew, not actually that he kind of flourished or developed a flourishing program. But I disagree with this. No, he did. He did. And actually, his contribution lives with us, but we don't feel it, as I will explain in the end. Can you warn me for the time?
No,
because
no,
apparently, yeah. I thought, you know, 45 minutes was like a century, but
I will. Sure.
This is basically the kind of manhajiyya Rashid Rida, the kind of the paradigm he followed and so on, the comprehensiveness. And please listen to these words, because Hassan al-Banna will acquire so many of them without even attributing them to Rida. يعني شمولية الإسلام دين ودولة نتفق نتعاون فيما اتفقنا عليه ونعذر بعضنا البعض فيما اختلفنا عليه. These are all so comprehensiveness, reform from within, that characterizes his program, reform from within. And this is a huge difference between him and Afghani and Abdu. And you will see now Islam's his firm belief that Islam is self-contained. يعني don't tell me, for example, God created two books, the book of nature and the book of revelation, and since they are coming from the same source, so anyone can do. He doesn't accept this. This was a statement of Abdu.
بالعربي كيف قال هذا؟
أن الله خلق الكون كتابا.
الإسلام self-contained بالعربي.
لا, this is my interpretation.
Okay.
لا, بس هو في المنهجية you will see أن الإصلاح يكون من الداخل. الإصلاح من الإسلام في ذاته. وليس من الغرب, for example, أنت يعني تقتبس من الغرب ثم تبني عليه أو تعطي له قشرة إسلامية. ده اللي عبده أفغاني عملوه. This is what عبده أنا وين did.
So, you know, I want to look at Abdu says like Islam is self-contained. This is your expression, not his.
لا, that's my description.
Yeah. يعني self-sufficient maybe. He means self-sufficient, not self-contained. Because self-contained is a negative
ممكن,
meaning.
ممكن.
Self-sufficient, I guess.
ممكن.
Because, you know, it's supposed to be earlier one, you know, like
yes.
Reform.
Yes, maybe it's better. Yes, self-sufficient is better.
It has like isolated kind of, you know.
Okay, if that's the what is understood, then self-sufficient is better. Yes. It's the same. Islam in this case is self-sufficient, meaning that. Anyway, still he believes that you can borrow from the West. You still borrow from, but within a self-contained framework of Islamic axioms, Islamic maqasid, and so on. But anyway, we can discuss it later, because maybe what you are saying is better, self-sufficient, we'll see. Then it rests on, this is his word, it rests on independence, istiqlaliyya, regeneration, I translated istinbat, istinbat has a deduction and inference and so on, but I think what he meant was regeneration, innovation, renewal, and he had a very important article in which he explained his idea of reform, renewal, it's called renewal, renewing, and renewers. Okay, now, why do I say it's much more comprehensive or different from Afghani? I'm going to be very brief about this, because I really, like in the chapter, explain Manhajiyya al-Afghani and Manhajiyya Abdu, daruri, taban. Like here, I'll just say that Afghani was moved by so many things, but primarily the concern about the unity of the Muslim nation, Wahdat al-Ummah al-Islamiyya. He was so concerned about this, and he came with this with the idea of pan-Islam and Ottomanism and all this with Sultan Abdul Hamid, but it didn't work. And confronting the external threat, how to confront it by, of course, rescuing Islam from decay and decline and regenerating Islam along the requirements of modern time. That was Afghani in a nutshell, but of course, I detail here all the kind of, you know, like the plan of action and so on. Idea of pan-Islamism, participation of everyone, restricted government, all of that. An idea of progress. And here, because this is again, will be a controversial thing when you criticize Afghani and Abdu, they were really obsessed. with the idea of التقدم. It obsessed them. It haunted them. Rashid Rida was not. Was not. يعني he also believed that the West, all of them, the intelligentsia at that time, you know, they looked into the secrets. These were the books. They entitled The Secrets Behind Western Superiority. يعني there was a sense of self-defeatism inside. يعني أحمد فتحي زغلول. أحمد فتحي زغلول, the brother of سعد زغلول, the leader of يعني the Egyptian nationalist movement, الوفد. He translated, I think it was Dumoulin's book, The Secret Behind the Superiority of the Anglo-Saxon. The Secret Behind the Superiority of the Anglo. Imagine if, for example, a Moroccan, I wouldn't be surprised nowadays, but يعني, or Tunisian, translated a book, The Secrets Behind the Superiority of the Israeli Race. The occupiers, محتلين. But that was the idea, this idea of, you know, progress. We have to learn their secrets, how the West ascended like this, how the West progressed like this. It became really kind of, they were all obsessed with this. I say Afghani and Abdu also fell into this trap of Western superiority, Western progress, despite their attempts to defend Islam. يعني, there's no question about this. But I will tell you the criticism now. Then I moved to Abdo. Of course, I explained that in the chapter, all the Afghani's reforms and so on. Abdo had also focused, especially after separating from Afghani, on two issues, intellectual reform and institutional reform. Again, the intellectual reform, his idea was based on fundamental assumptions, significance of the role of religion in life of nations, need for new institutions and technical skills to meet the demands of modern life. The same idea. Islam is good, but it needed the skills, Western skills, and the secrets of the West, and so on, in order to progress. It's okay. That's how we all believe now. Now we have to learn in the West and learn English, and we all believe in this. But at that time, the context was completely different. This is a time where, you know, the Muslim society was plagued by occupation. This is the time also where a kind of, you know, a synthesized model had to emerge in order to preserve the identity and preserve the coherence of the Muslim communities. I will show you now how both of their frameworks actually diluted Islam in that. So Abdo believed in this, whereas, of course, the word التقدم, التقدم, التقدم was really an obsession for Lavani. For Abdo, it was الفضائل المدنية, civic virtues, الفضائل المدنية. يعني everything الفضائل المدنية, الفضائل المدنية, civic virtues that will be the key behind the progress of nations, يعني تقدم الأمم. The need for progress and development if Islam was to survive and catch with the West. Social progress by civic virtues. يعني, and he compared this, يعني what led the West is the civic, the superiority of the West was civic virtues, and we need to acquire these. However, Islam has it, has them embedded in the Quran and in the traditions and so on. So Islam possesses these virtues. Muslims need to regenerate them, abandon taqlid, and exercise reason. Okay? All right. Now, the idea of progress again, I you know, I spent some time discussing the issue of reason and science and how they wanted actually to prove that Islam was a religion of science to the extent that that affected, this is the story that you all know, Abdu's interpretation of the Quran. يعني سورة الفيل, فأرسلنا عليهم طيرا أبابيل ترميهم بحجارة من سجيل فجعلهم كعصف مأكول. قال لك دول فيروس, ميكروبات. These are microbes and viruses. عبده. The jinn, for example, same thing. He denied يعني, the existence of jinn. قال لك these are delusions and you know, it's all self-made from psychological trouble and psychological issues. يعني what he was trying to do, على فكرة, I'm not trying to undermine him, but he was trying to take it a step further without realizing the consequences of that approach. And we'll see what happened with that approach. Then he talked about ibadat. You all know about these ibadat wa mu'amalat, wal maslaha wa talfiq. Talfiq, as he called it, talfiq bayna al mazahib, in order to move forward and eliminate ta'assub and extremism bayna atba' al mazahib and so on. The other one is education, institutional education, taba'an. And then reform of Al-Azhar, reform of Sharia courts, reform of the endowments. He wrote reports, extensive reports about all of these reforms and submitted them to To where? Lord Cromer. Lord Cromer. He submitted them to... This is the problem. This is the problem and shows you there is a structural problem here. It was not an issue of self-sufficiency of the reform program, but it is an issue of let's use the British and Lord Cromer in order to advance these reforms, which happened gradually. He didn't submit them to Khadawi, for example, to his king. He Rida always submitted them to Sultan Abd al-Hamid, Sharif Hussein, Jam'iyyat al-Ittihad al-Tarqi, always the head of his own state. He submitted all of his reforms to them. طيب. So, خلاص من الريبورت, critique of both of them to prove or to make the argument that Rida was different. Both Afghani and Abdu couldn't develop a true synthesis or a coherent program in which Islam can lead the progress of change. At best, it was Islam or something else. Islam by itself cannot do it. It has to be with Western values, Western progress, تقدم الغربي وهكذا. This was their ideas, by the way. يعني that's where we, عشان to be fair, we all know, we all familiar with the expression of Abdu. I go, يعني he used to say, يعني to, when, before traveling to Europe, I'm going to Europe to energize myself. أشحن نفسي. That's in Arabic, أشحن نفسي. عشان يروح لأوروبا. Or the famous cliche, I go to Europe, I see Muslims with no Islam, and I go back to the Muslim society, I see Islam without Muslims. It was inherent, يعني it was deep in their mind. The most important problem is that they both diluted Islam. How they diluted? By trying to create this unsuccessful synthesis. يعني Afghani and Abdu, they call for pan-Islam and at the same time acknowledge al-Wataniya and nationalism. Both are good. They tell you both are good. You want nationalism, fine. You want pan-Islam, fine. Or Abdu says, for example, the progress cannot be achieved by Sharia only, but ولكن بالعقل أيضا. بالعقل أيضا. Abdu طبعا was a master. He was a mufti. People think that he was Sheikh al-Azhar. He was never Sheikh al-Azhar, but he was a mufti. So he knows what he was doing. He can do it, this calculation in his head. But I tell you the consequences or the impact of this line of thought or thinking on his followers. So he says the Sharia cannot do it only. فقط. ولكن بالعقل أيضا. Or when they say, for example, as I mentioned, the civic virtues, the issue of civic virtues. إن الأمة تتقدم بالفضائل المدنية أو بالقيم الدينية. Moral, religious values أو بالفضائل المدنية. Both can lead to the same conclusion. أو إن الله خلق كتابين, كتاب الطبيعة وكتاب الوحي, وحيث أنهما خرج من نفس المصدر فلا يمكن أن يتناقضا. استخدم أي شيء. طيب, what was the consequences of this? They had followers, they had disciples. The disciples are, for example, some of the أحمد لطفي السيد, طه حسين, قاسم أمين, أحمد فتحي زغلول, سعد زغلول, yes, رشيد رضا طبعا. ها؟ To some extent. ورشيد رضا. لا هو رشيد رضا and so on. So what was the consequences of this? Immediately, of course, since civic virtues lead to the same thing as religion, and since Sharia عقل would lead to the same thing as Sharia, let's go and take the secular trend and let's make religion respect religion. And they all respected religion, by the way, including سعد زغلول. يعني سعد زغلول, sorry again, احنا were recording when I don't like the light recording. سعد زغلول, when they told him that الشيخ علي عبد الرازق كتب كتاب الإسلام وأصول الحكم, فقال ماذا قال؟ قال كذا وكذا وكذا. الحمار مين اللي يقول الكلام ده؟ سعد زغلول. يعني even he should have embraced, يعني المفروض ان هو يتبنى هذه المقوله لانه كان علماني. لكن قال الحمار مين ده؟ مش ممكن يكون اتخرج من الازهر. That's what he said بالظبط. حمار مين؟ مش ممكن يكون اتخرج من الازهر على علي عبد الرازق. قاسم امين ده نفس الشيء, ولكن دي كانت افكار اقتبسوها. These are the ideas that they, you know, like inferred, deduced from this line of thinking. And let's make religion a private matter. This is exactly secularism. ما هو بيقول الوطنية كويسة والإسلام كويس. خلينا وطنيين وناخد استقلالنا من الإنجليز. يعني they say nationalism is good, بيزد اون ريس وكل حاجه، لان دي اقوى روابط، وروابط الدم وروابط الجنس ورابط الارض ومش عارف. افغاني اكسبلايند اول ذس، وعبده اكسبلايند اول ذس ان ديتيل، ذا كومبوننتس اوف سيكولر ناشوناليزم. So let's do it and get rid of the British gradually. Benefit and get rid of them gradually and so on. طيب, so one stream هنا you can situate بقى رشيد رضا and you see the separation even من أفغاني وعبده. This is يعني يعني فعلا سببت في انشقاق التام عن تلامذة عبده, خاصة after 1911 and الحرب العالمية الأولى, the World War One. Why 1911? The Italian occupation of Libya. طبعا الخلافة العثمانية تقريبا راحت, الاتحاد والترقي في اسطنبول, دعوا للجهاد الاسلاميين, دعوا يعني التيار الاسلامي في وش, طبعا ما كانش في حاجه اسمها تيار اسلامي ذاك, بس they called for jihad, nobody responded. All the Egyptian elites, they said, you know, the hell with them, خلاص احنا مصر المصريين. Who actually raised the slogan of مصر المصريين? Guess. افغاني. أفغاني was the first one to raise the slogan مصر المصريين. طيب كرومر قال لهم إيه؟ He caught this immediately and he said, look, مصر المصريين, you are, لسعد زغلول and all the rest, you are the quote, you are the real stakeholders of Egypt. لا الخديوي ولا العثماني ولا الكلام ده كله. أنتم أصحاب المصالح الحقيقية في مصر, وأنا البيترون بتاعكم, أنا الرئيس بتاعكم بقى. That's why he submitted to Cromer. طيب طبعا رضا realized all this pitfall. The Islam بيروح كده يعني, it's going down the drain. Islam and Muslim societies and this type of structure and organization is going down. So I mentioned this argument. So both of the arguments, so both of them were infatuated by the West. Islam was not self-contained, self-sufficient, despite their efforts to come to its defense. تمام. منهج رشيد رضا or his methodology بقى or his approach. The first sentence is the most important sentence. Still, I didn't develop it well, but I need really to write four lines. Otherwise, it doesn't work. But his, if you wish, approach was to preserve the basic tenets of the Muslim Ummah when undertaking reform and filter the process of acquisition, borrowing an acquisition of Western aspects through these tenets. فلتر. يعني فلترت هذه عملية الاقتباس من الغرب, فلترت عملية الاقتباس من الغرب. فمثلا في البوليتكس, ensure the unity of the Muslim nation or nations and the caliphate, the persistence, perseverance of the caliphate or the Islamic state أو الدولة الإسلامية. ده for him the, يعني المينيمم في الإصلاح السياسي أنك تحافظ على وحدة الأمة الإسلامية لغاية ما مات على فكرة, until his death. And دولة الخلافة, ولما فشلت دولة الخلافة وسقطت دولة, نموذج البحث عن نموذج لدولة إسلامية. في الإديوكيشن, إديوكيشن starts with religious components. يعني ركن الإصلاح التعليم, ركن الإصلاح عامة, ذكرها في أكثر من موقع. ركن الأساسي للإصلاح هو الإصلاح الديني. الإصلاح الديني والتكوين الديني ده ركن الإصلاح في أي مجال. As a foundation, then introduce modern subjects. The Quranic interpretation, وده مهم جدا, ودي أكبر نقطة بقى يعني the if you wish, sorry for the expression, the catch رشيد رضا in it. Real interpretation, Quranic interpretation. إن هو he was relying always على الحديث وعلى السند وعلى آراء السلف وأقوال المفسرين بخلاف عبده. عبده كان العقل على طول يعني, وكان أقوال السلف مش مهمة بالنسبة له, بالنسبة لعبده, وكان التأويل, موضوع التأويل. رشيد رضا لا, فيش كلام ده كله يعني, ما كانش كان يرفض عملية التأويل إلا إذا عجز. This idea of relying on the salaf, on the hadith, on the sanad, and many people, even يعني Western scholars criticized him for this. He spent so much time improving أسانيد الأحاديث, إن الحديث صحيح وكذا, وبالتالي هو يستخدمه في التفسير وأشياء بهذا القبيل. أما التجديد الدنيوي, يعني the other aspects بقى اللي هو worldly aspects of reform, فهي says إننا نحتاج إلى تجديد استقلالي كتجديد اليابان ما قالش خلاص خلصنا من أوروبا وخلصنا من فرنسا وخلصنا من اللي عرفناه، دول مستعمرين وظالمين. في النهاية هو وصل لهذا الأمر ويجب أن يحاربوا عسكريا، هنوصل لهذا الموضوع. إننا نحتاج لتقليل تجديد الاستقلال كتجديد اليابان ترتقي به مصالحنا الاقتصادية والعسكرية والسياسية، وتنمي أو تنمى أو تنمى أو تنمى ثرواتنا الزراعية والصناعية والتجارية، ونكون به أمة عزيزة ودولة قوية، مع حفظ مقومات أمتنا دين وثقافة وتشريع ولغة، وحفظ مشخصاتها القومية its national characteristics وعادات حسنة وآداب. That's in a nutshell his vision or perspective of research. I'm not saying that Abdu Afghani didn't hold the same views, but their approach was different. Their approach actually led to this bifurcation of Islam into a secular. Well, this is the idea of many people. It's not my original idea. The second argument is that we said that he was different. وعنده كان methodology مختلفة unique. The second argument is that Rida's reform was multifaceted and comprehensive. يعني أفغاني, look at Afghani, for example, in social reform أو economic reform أو حتى يعني educational reform. Very little. يعني generalities. عبده more of educational reform. هو لا. كان عنده religious reform program واضح وكلير. I don't say that it is يعني wow, it's successful and it's serious. لا, but at least he formulated one. Religious reform, educational reform, social reform, political reform, and practical reform. طيب, religious reforms, of course, the idea of the correct doctrine, إصلاح العقيدة. إن العقيدة لازم تهذب وتصلح وهكذا. وطبعا في نظره العقيدة علمنا بعد يعني by maybe in twenties he said this, علمنا علم اليقين أن مذهب السلف هو الحق. الذي السلف هنا مش يعني حركة السلفية الحديثة, لا, السلف اللي هم السلف
السابقين
بالضبط مش الحركة السلفية. هو الحق الذي ليس وراءه غاية ولا مطلب. شوف ده رجل عجوز دلوقتي يعني بيقول بيوزن كلامه. He weighs what he's saying. هو الحق الذي ليس وراءه غاية ولا مطلب, وأن كل ما خلفه فهو ظنون وأوهام لا تغني من الحق شيئا. فده بالنسبة لتصريح العقيدة. طبعا نبذ التعصب المذهبي والتقليد, abandoned blind adherence to the legal schools. He even proposed, this is one of his proposals, he proposed unifying all the legal schools under one book. In the common agreements between legal schools should be included in a book. And then you leave the اللي هم الفروع, subsidiary issues, up to the person. لكن المسائل الأصول تجمع في كتاب واحد, اللي هو زي الفقه على المذاهب الأربعة يعني. تمام؟ طبعا يعني this is maybe a leap but I can't prove it. بس لو تشوف مثلا رسالة التعليم لحسن البنا جمع فيها الأقوال عن الصفات والتأويل وهكذا, ومعظم الأمور الخلافية جمعها في 20-30 صفحة واحطها لأتباع وخلصت من الجدل المذهبي والجدل الخلافي وآراء المعتزلة وآراء مش عارف من الأشعرية وآراء, خلص من الكلام ده كله في كتاب واحد. طبعا حاول ان هو to bridge الجاب between the Sunnah and Shia.
انا how many do I
have? 5 minutes.
5 minutes. طيب خلاص, وبقول طبعا نعمل فيه, هو حط بلان how to reconcile between the Shia and the Sunni, قضية الاجتهاد, قضية البدع والصوفية وهكذا, وبعد كده طبعا محاربة دعاة الإلحاد والتغريب والعلمانية. This يعني combating طبعا all these kind of misunderstandings that were promoted by اللي هم هو سماهم شباب الجامعات, واختص طبعا بالنقد طه حسين في أيام وعلي عبد الرزاق. طبعا educational reform at two levels, the curriculum الأزهر and establishing مدرسة الدعوة والإرشاد. وده كان مشروع يعني this was really an important project, very very important project and very important idea. يعني هي فكرة الجامعة الحضرية, أعتقد أنا أعطيت محاضرة عن هذا الموضوع قبل كده هنا, عن موضوع الجامعة الحضرية. إنها this is a university that has a cultural civilizational mission and it will form leaders for the future to reform the Islamic Ummah. social and economic reform, critical, he was critical, of course, of Sufism, of religious scholars, stagnant religious scholars. And as I mentioned, of course, he tried to promote the idea of women education to counterbalance, of course, the calls by Qasim Amin, the liberation of women and the new women and all of these women liberation movement. Political reform, he had a statement that's very important. He used to say always, لا إصلاح دون دولة. You cannot achieve reform without a state. Yeah, a proper Islamic state. You cannot achieve the reform without the state. For one of his main objectives was to re-establish a Sharia-based system that can respond to modern needs. Sharia requires an authority to protect it and implement it. Sharia cannot be reformed without an Islamic state. That's in a nutshell, which is the caliphate in his view. He tried to reform to propose reform, suggested a proposal to the Ottoman Empire, the CEUP, as I mentioned, and at the end of his life, he was in a continuous search for an Islamic state that will be or succeed the collapsed Ottoman Empire or Ottoman Caliphate. He went after, of course, Sharif Hussein, and it didn't work. He went after King Faisal of Syria. It didn't work. He went after King Abdul Aziz Al Saud. He didn't work. He knew what this man was doing. So in the end, 1925, and after immediately 1 year after the collapse of the Caliphate, he wrote his book. It's a very important book, Al Khilafa aw Al Imam Al Uzma, and he talked about two things that Abdul Razak Al Sanhuri, the legalist. Egyptian legalist also was very much influenced by this, or proposed the same thing. They distinguish between two types of caliphate, khilafat al-darura, naqisa. That's what Sanhuri called it, khilafat al-naqisa. He called it khilafat al-darura. It's a necessity. We don't have all the requirements that should be embodied in a caliph, but it's khilafat al-darura, and we accept it. Then until we establish khilafat al-ijtihad. خلافة الاجتهاد خلافة الخليفة المجتهد that can exercise اجتهاد, and he explained of course how practically he was very active in the again unlike Abdu for example, he was very active in establishing congresses, organizations and so on and so forth, and important ones, very important ones, trying again to play a major role in how to rescue the Arab at that time the nation after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire and after the mandate system and so on. I will conclude by saying his contributions, one of course I mentioned reform from within, he started with admiration of the West and the reforms, and then of course he came up with this the framework that I talked about. This is another major contribution, actually it was Novel. Rida read a translation of Tocqueville. Tocqueville, in his book about America, he mentioned that the secret behind American progress was, of course, in its democracy and in its associations. اللي هو المجتمع المدني اللي احنا بنقول عليه. He acquired this early on, by the way. And whenever there was an issue, he will tell you, let's form a جمعية للقيام على هذا الأمر. And he established and participated and co-founded in many associations. Some of them actually exist until now. One of them is Jamiat Shubba al-Muslimin. He was a co-founder of Jamiat Shubba, a major co-founder of Jamiat Shubba al-Muslimin, for example. And he mentioned الجمعيات إنما يقوم بذلك على الوجه النافع خيار الأمة دينا وعقلا وأدبا. The elites. بتأليف الجمعيات الخيرية والعلمية. فإن لم يوجد من هؤلاء من يقوم بهذا العمل على وجهه بالتعاون فإن الأمة تظل مذبذبة لا يستقيم لها أمر ولا يتم فيها إصلاح. ده الكلام بتاع المجتمع المدني الوقت اللي الأمريكان بيبيعوا لنا بالضبط كده. بس هو طبعا كان بيتكلم على أساس تقوية الأمة الإسلامية ويبيلد something up again. مين اللي أخذ الفكرة دي بعد كده وريلي emulated or took this idea؟ حسن البنا. بالضبط حسن البنا. grassroots and bottom up. وده اللي وصل لرشيد رضا. رشيد رضا وصل لعدة قناعات ما كتبش كلها, ولكن أعتقد they were transpired to حسن البنا, وأنا I'll mention some of them. Third, grassroots activism. هو خلاص يعني فعلا at the end of his life يعني he became very frustrated with this kind of elitist ideas intellectual reform and all this. قال خلاص احنا we go grassroots to the extent of the British, how to deal with the British. He mentioned armed resistance. He called them العصابات المسلحة اللي هي الميليشيا. مين برضك acquired this later on؟ حسن البنا في حرب الإخوان في القناة مع الإنجليز. ميليشيا to fight. دي هنا كان he was very very perceptive about this and he had the foresight. He said that he published one article in the end of the 19th century and two or three, I think the last one was maybe in the 20s and so on before the creation of Israel. He said Israel will be a state of Israel will be created and it will expand without borders and it will occupy South Lebanon, West Bank and Sinai. And he said the best way to fight the Zionist project is not by regular armies but by militias. Hamas. That's he said it early on, and I wrote an article about this, his perception of Israel and so on. Anyway, طبعا الarmed resistance. وبعد كده طبعا حسن البنا اللي هي no reform without state, اللي هي الإسلام دين ودولة and so on. I also claimed that he started or he initiated a transformation. This is my last sentences. To a new phase. Yes, this is the phase of activism, grassroots, this idea of Islam deen wa dawla, well, idea of forming, you know, like institutions in society, grassroots institutions in society. Thank you so much for your patience. I hope it was not yani.
Thank you very much.